The outline of our program would be as such. We will be starting with a welcome note by the president of our alumni association, Advocate Prasad Naik, followed by an introduction of our keynote speaker, who is our resource person, Judge Edgar Fernandez. Thereafter, without any delay, we'll be starting with the main talk. I request you to patiently listen to the entire seminar. Please keep your mics on mute. You may, however, keep your video on. Also, refrain from entering anything in the chat box during the session. You may, however, type your questions at the time of the interactive session. So please avoid typing anything during the session or the talk of Judge Edgar Fernandez, but you may type it during the interactive session. Also, if you wish to address any particular question and you are scared that the question might not be audible due to your internet connectivity, you may send it to me on my WhatsApp number. My number is 800-775-9955. I repeat, 800-775-9955. You may also send it in the chat box, as we have discussed. This is only done so that due to any internet connectivity problem, you are not interrupted from asking your question. The entire session will also be recorded, and you can see that once it is uploaded on YouTube. The option for muting the mic is at the bottom of the screen. For those who haven't yet muted the screen yet. Okay. Now, I call upon Advocate Prasad Naik to deliver the welcome note.
Thank you, Adish. Respected Honorable Sri Edgar Fernandez, District Judge 1 and Margao, members of the judiciary, my senior and junior colleagues participating in today's webinar. On behalf of G.R. Kare College of Law Alumni Association, it is my pleasure to welcome you all for today's webinar. The Alumni Association has decided to regularly organize such webinars so that we can share our knowledge with each other and also acquire knowledge from experts. I take this opportunity to request all the alumnus of G.R. Kare College of Law to join the association so that we remain connected to each other and also to our alma mater. And with this short welcome speech, it is my privilege to flag off this webinar. I now call upon Advocate Riya Halankar to introduce our resource person. Over to you, Riya.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Respected judges, senior advocates, and my fellow colleagues, a very good morning to all of you. It's a great honor for me to introduce our resource person for today, Honorable Judge Sri Edgar Placido Fernandez. Judge Edgar Placido Fernandez was born on 21st February 1984 at Kunkolim, Goa. He has passed BSc in physics in the year 1984 from Srimati Parvati Bai Chokhale College of Arts and Science at Margao, Goa. He is an alumni of our college, Govind Ramnath Kare College of Law, and has passed LLB in the year 1994, and thereafter he has completed his LLM in the year 1997 from Shivaji University at Kolhapur. He enrolled as an advocate and started practicing from February 1994.
Is there a problem with the mic?
Riya, can you start? Riya, I think there's some issue with Riya's this thing. Riya?
Mute
Ria, your mic seems to be off. Ria.
Is the district additional district church.
Ask her to unmute. I'm asking her to unmute.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, now you are. Now you are. Yes.
Sorry, I was on mute.
That's okay.
Respected judges, senior advocates, and all my fellow colleagues, a very good morning to all of you. It is a great honor for me to introduce our resource person for today, Honorable Judge Sri Edgar Placido Fernandez. Judge Edgar Placido Fernandez was born on 21st February 1964 at Kunkolim, Goa. Judge Edgar Fernandez has passed BSc in Physics in the year 1984 from Srimati Parvati Bai Chowdhury College of Arts and Science at Margaon, Goa. He is an alumni of our college, Govind Ramnath Kari College of Law, and has passed LLB in the year 1994, and thereafter he has passed LLM in the year 1997 from Shivaji University at Kolhapur. He enrolled as an advocate and started practicing from February 1995 in the trial courts as well as in the Honorable High Court of Bombay at Panaji, Goa. He has worked as a part-time lecturer in G.R. Kari College of Law from September 1997 to October 1998. He has also worked as a part-time lecturer in business law at CS College of Arts and Commerce at Kunkolim, Goa from July 1999 to March 2000. On 15th July 2000, he was appointed and posted as Civil Judge Junior Division and Judicial Magistrate First Class at Ponda, Goa. He was then promoted as Civil Judge Senior Division and Judicial Magistrate First Class in the year 2006. Thereafter, he has been promoted as Additional District Judge. Honorable Judge Sri Edgar Fernandez is presently posted as District Judge 1 and Additional Sessions Judge at Margaon, Goa. With a short introduction, I hereby request Honorable Judge Sri Edgar Fernandez to kindly take over and share his views, wisdom, and knowledge on the topic for today. Thank you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Ria. Good morning, everyone. My brother and sister judges, I'm going to understand that you are also joined in. The members of the bar, first of all, I must congratulate the Alumni Association for taking the initiative to take up this topic. Though Section 20 of the Commercial Courts Act categorically makes it the responsibility of the state government to train and continuously educate the judges who may be appointed to the commercial courts, my personal view is that the object of the Act will only be fulfilled if the bar is fully conversant with the provisions of the Act. So congratulations to the association once again. I am humbled by the fact that the association has felt me worthy to deliver a talk on this new but very important topic. I must disclose to you that I am not an expert on the subject. My expertise, if it can be called so, is limited to the fact that I have dealt with commercial suits and in that process have taken a closer look at some of the provisions with the active assistance of the members of the bar. So today, let us take a deeper look at the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act. Can I, Mr. Prasadna, can I share my screen?
Yes, sir. I have permitted. Yes.
Yeah, I don't know what to do with that now.
please.
So your audio seems to be muted. No. Yes, he muted. No, I'm not. He muted.
Just a minute.
Right.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Now, basically, this legislation was conceived in the year 2003 by the 17th Law Commission of India, when, by its Suomoto report, it recommended the constitution of the commercial division in each high court. This need was felt because of some circumstances, like the change in economic policies of the country post 1991, the perception in the foreign courts that Indian judicial system had collapsed due to intraday delays. There was a need for a fast disposal of high value commercial disputes. And there was a need for providing assurance to domestic and foreign investors. And after the Commercial Courts Act 2015 came into force, it was felt that the global economy environment had become increasingly competitive, and to attract business at the international level, India needed to further improve its ranking in the World Bank Doing Business report, which considers the dispute resolution environment. This fact prompted initiating legislative measures for speedy settlement of commercial disputes, widen the scope of the courts to deal with commercial disputes, and facilitate ease of doing business. Now, let us first look at, before we get into anything, let us first look at what changes were introduced by the Act and the Amendment of 2018. The Act firstly constituted the commercial courts at district level, commercial divisions in high courts having ordinary civil jurisdiction, and commercial appellate division in all the high courts, fixing the minimum pecuniary jurisdiction of such commercial courts and commercial divisions, and amended CPC to apply to commercial courts and commercial divisions. Huh? Am I audible?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. By the 2018 amendment, the specified value of commercial disputes was reduced from the existing 1 crore to 3 lakh rupees. It enabled the state governments, with respect to the high courts having ordinary civil, original civil jurisdiction, to constitute commercial courts at district judge level. It enabled the state governments, except territories over which high courts have ordinary civil jurisdiction, to designate appellate courts at district judge level. It enabled state governments to specify such pecuniary value of commercial disputes, which shall not be less than 3 lakh rupees, or such higher value for the whole or part of the state, and provided for compulsory mediation before institution of a suit where no urgent relief is contemplated. With this in mind, let us look at the object of the Act. It is to provide for speedy disposal of high value commercial disputes, to create a positive image to the investor world about the independent and responsive Indian legal system. Now, before we move forward, let us look at this observation of the Honorable Apex Court. It said, keeping in view the object and purpose of the establishment of the commercial courts and fast-tracking procedure provided under the Act, the statutory provisions of the Act and the words incorporated therein are to be meaningfully interpreted for quick disposal of commercial litigation so as to benefit the litigants, especially those who are engaged in trade and commerce, which in turn will further economic growth of the country. Now, for that, we'll first look at the jurisdiction of the commercial courts. Section 6 gives jurisdiction to the commercial courts to try all suits and applications relating to a commercial disputes of a specified value. Therefore, for the commercial courts to have jurisdiction or to get jurisdiction, there are two factors involved. One, there should be a commercial dispute. And second, that commercial dispute has to be of a specified value. If both these things are not there, the commercial court does not get jurisdiction. Therefore, now first look at what a commercial dispute is. Section 2.1c defines commercial disputes. And it starts with the words, means a dispute arising out of one, ordinary transactions of merchants, bankers, financiers, and traders, such as those relating to mercantile documents, including enforcement and interpretation of such documents. I have underlined the second part of this definition just for us to think whether the first part is controlled by the second part of this definition. The next is export and import of merchandise of services, issues relating to admiralty and maritime law, transactions relating to aircraft, aircraft engines, aircraft equipment and helicopters, including sales, leasing and financing of the same, carriage of goods. Is there a problem?
Sir, I think you have not shared your screen, sir. Everybody is asking.
I have not shared?
No. Just see.
Oh, just a minute. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Is it okay now?
Yeah. Yes.
I'm sorry. Still getting used to the systems. Okay. 2.1c defines commercial dispute. I said I was telling you it starts with the words means a dispute arising out of ordinary transaction of merchants, bankers, financiers and traders, such as those relating to mercantile documents, including enforcement and interpretation of the documents. I was talking about the second part of the definition, which I have underlined, only to think whether the second part controls the first part. Then export or import of merchandise or services, issues relating to admiralty and maritime law, transactions relating to aircraft, aircraft engines, aircraft equipment and helicopters, including sales, leasing and financing of the same. Carriage of goods, construction and infrastructure contracts, including tenders, agreements relating to immovable property used exclusively in trade or commerce. Again, the underlining is to find out whether the second part controls the first part. Then franchising agreements, distribution and licensing agreements, management and consultancy agreements, joint venture agreements, shareholders agreements, subscription and investment agreements pertaining to service industry, including outsourcing services and financial services, mercantile agency and mercantile users, partnership agreements, technology development agreements, intellectual property rights relating to registered and unregistered trademarks, copyright, patent, design, domain names, etc., etc., agreement for sales of goods or provisions of services, exploitation of oil, gas, reserves, natural resources, insurance and reinsurance, contracts of agency, and such other commercial disputes as may be notified by the central government. Now, having understood, I mean, having seen what it includes, this is a very important explanation. It says that the commercial dispute shall not cease to be a commercial dispute merely because it involves an action for recovery of immovable property or for realization of monies out of immovable property given as security or involves any other relief pertaining to the immovable property. And the second part is where just because it is one of the contracting parties, the state or any of its agencies or instrumentalities or a private body carrying out public functions. Now, let us see how the courts have interpreted this or told us, I mean, explained how the act is to be interpreted. In Havells India Limited, this is a Delhi High Court judgment. It said that the parliament has consciously given the precise definition of what a commercial dispute means. It is not an inclusive definition. And the specific matters which qualify as relating to commercial disputes have been specially set out in clauses 1 to 21. And for a dispute to be a commercial dispute, it is essential, first and foremost, that there has to be a dispute. Unless the plaintiff discloses a dispute, the mere fact that the plaintiff may have sought the relief which may relate to a subject matter and listed in clause 1 to 21, 22, of section 21C of the Commercial Courts Act, it would not render the dispute arising in the suit as a commercial dispute. Now, again, the Delhi High Court in Sanjeev Kumar Arora versus Satish Mohan Agarwal has said that the statement of objects and reasons for enactment of the law would be defeated if doors of commercial courts or commercial divisions of the high courts were to be opened too wide by giving an extensive interpretation to section 21C of the Act defining what is a commercial dispute, and the whole purpose of classifying commercial dispute and specifying the value thereof shall be lost. And finally, the apex court in Ammalal Enterprises versus KS Infrastructure has said that the object shall be fulfilled only if the provisions of the Act are interpreted in a narrow sense and not hampered by the usual procedural delays plaguing our traditional legal system. Now, having seen how it is to be interpreted, let us look at some of these definitions where the second part was underlined. The first one, ordinary transactions of merchants, bankers, finance, and traders, such as those relating to mercantile documents, including enforcement and interpretation of such documents. Now, we have a Delhi High Court judgment in Kailash Devi Khanna versus DD Global Capital Limited, and it says that all suits for recovery of monies cannot fall under clause 1 of section 21C if the suit is not based on any transaction relating to mercantile documents. It cannot be filed as a commercial suit. Therefore, it appears that the mere suit for recovery is not maintainable under the Commercial Courts Act. Now, in the Tamil Nadu High Court, in R. Kumar and others versus T. A. Jawahar Alia, says that section 2C1 cannot be read in isolation, but has to be read along with all the other classes of disputes which have been included into the definition. The emphasis is on the document evidencing the transaction and not the persons transacting. Every transaction of these classes of person does not automatically become a commercial transaction unless the transaction is effected through a mercantile document. And that it further said that the objects of the Act would also lend support to this view. Now let us look at the other transaction which relates to aircraft engines, aircraft equipment and helicopters. Now this is a very interesting case of the Delhi High Court. Qatar Airways filed a suit against the airport authorities of India.
Hello?
Yes? Is yes? Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Sir, you're audible. I think there's some mistake with somebody's audio.
Okay.
I request all the participants to kindly mute their audios, no? Please.
Now, in this case, a suit for recovery was filed by the airlines for loss, for damages suffered, damages caused to their aircraft, which they attributed to the defendants And the Honorable High Court says that this cannot constitute a commercial dispute within the meaning of the Commercial Courts Act. Now, agreements related to immovable property used exclusively in trade and commerce. I think this is one that we come across very often with at our jurisdiction. And therefore, this is very important for us. Now, Ambalal's case, the apex court said the words used exclusively in trade and commerce are to be interpreted purposefully, and that the word used denotes actually used, and it cannot be either readied for use or likely to be used or to be used. It should be actually used. And then a little further, in fact, the Honorable Apex Court says it is necessary to plead and indicate the same was being used in trade and commerce. Now, if you go to the various judgments of the Honorable High Courts, as well as the Apex Court on this subject of what dispute would come within the, and the consistent view of all the High Courts, as well as the Apex Court, is that you have to plead for that the property was used exclusively, or to bring it within there has to be pleading to bring it within the jurisdiction of the Commercial Courts Act. Now, in Hindpal Singh Jabal and Sumar Singh and others, these are both Delhi High Court judgments, which says that the sale is a conveyance of immovable property and does not fall within the expressions of agreement relating to immovable property. And as such, it does not fall within the ambit of the commercial dispute as specified in Section 21C. Now, Soni Dave and others versus Transition Industries. This is again a Delhi High Court judgment. It says the property prescribed, the user whereof, as per the law, is residential, even if let out for use exclusively in trade or commerce, or when without being so let out, is used exclusively in trade or commerce, the same would still not qualify as a new immovable property used exclusively in trade or commerce within the meaning of Section 21(7). Now, intellectual property rights relating to registered and unregistered trademarks, copyrights, patents, etc. Now, in this case, Havells India Limited filed a suit against the Advertising Standards Council. They took objections to an order of the Standard Councils of India in asking them to either withdraw or modify an advertisement, their advertisement campaign featuring its distinctive tagline and trademark, wires that don't catch fire. And it said that it lies in the realm of advertisement and does not raise a commercial dispute within the meaning of Section 21C of the Commercial Act. If you remember when we started, I talked about Havells when it said how we interpret, it is from this case. It says that this was what is the finding, and that is why the court said so. Now, once having understood what are commercial disputes, we move on to the second requirement which gives the commercial court's jurisdiction, which will give the commercial court's jurisdiction, and that is specified value. Now, according to Section 2.1, specified value is the value of the subject matter of the suit as determined in accordance with Section 12. However, it cannot be less than rupees 3 lakhs or such higher value as may be notified by the central government. So let us look at Section 12.1. Now, this basically is 12.1 talks about tells us how this value has to be arrived at. It says if it is a suit for recovery, the value should be the money sought to be recovered, inclusive of interest, if any, computed up to the date of filing. Secondly, whether relief relates to movable property or right therein, the market value of the property as on the date of filing. When it is immovable property or a right to therein, the market value of the immovable property as on the date of filing, and where the relief sought relates to any other intangible right, it is the market value of the said rights as estimated by the plaintiff. This is because the plaintiff is the dominus litus. Now, jurisdiction in respect of arbitration matters. This is dealt with by Section 10 of the Act. It basically differentiates between arbitration of a commercial dispute of a specified value between international commercial arbitration and other than international commercial arbitration. All applications or appeals arising from international commercial arbitration are to be heard and disposed by the Commercial Division of the High Court. Subsection 1 says so. All applications or appeals arising from an arbitration which is not an international commercial arbitration are to be heard by the Commercial Division if the High Court has original jurisdiction, civil jurisdiction. This is what subsection 2 tells us. Now, where such applications or appeals would ordinarily lie before the principal civil court of original jurisdiction in a district, they will be heard and disposed by the commercial court exercising jurisdiction. Now, these are basically those arbitration matters where we come into the picture that were normally being filed before the district court as the court of principal civil court of original jurisdiction. They will go to the commercial court if the value is within the specified value. Now, pre-institution mediation and settlement. Now, this is one provision that the amended Act has brought in. It says 12A, it says that a suit which does not contemplate an urgent interim relief cannot be instituted unless plaintiff exhausts the remedy of pre-institution mediation. Now here, I have underlined, I've given stress on this word, which does not contemplate any urgent interim relief, because would it be that just because the plaintiff asks for an urgent relief, would it come under Section 12A? Now, it would depend if your pleadings themselves should contemplate such an urgent relief. If it is not there in your pleadings, then maybe not. From my reading of the various different, there is no direct ruling on this. But then from the idea that you get from reading of the various authorities or wherever this is discussed, looks like this will be granted with this Section 12A could be invoked only if the plaintiff manages to show that time runs against him. If it did not happen, then everything falls. In fact, there was one judgment which says that there was a case where some material had come and there were because of some, it was pending at some port, it was a perishable item, and because there was a dispute between the defendants, the plaintiff could not unload his goods, by which he was suffering, the goods probably would perish. So in these circumstances, the court said, yeah, here it is, the time is running against the plaintiff. So Section 12A has to be invoked. Now, we have the mediation rules under this Act. It is not a part of my presentation, but it is good for all of us to go through the rules. It gives us the format of the application to be made by the plaintiff. It tells us what report the mediator should show if the defendant, in spite of a notice, does not come. A report should go that it is a no-show, not shown by the defendant. If there is a failure report should go. And if there's a settlement, then it is to be settled. It also prescribes the fees of the what are to be deposited before the District Legal Services Authority for the as arbitration fees. So please go through there, the rules, or probably if I don't know, I think I have a PDF document. If there is time, maybe we can look at it. If there is, it is available on my laptop. Now, Section 16. Is the one that changed the world for us. It amended the provisions of the CPC in their application to any suit in respect of a commercial dispute of a specified value was, I mean, this was done. Now, please remember here also that these amended provisions would apply to only those commercial suits which are of a specified value and not all commercial suits. Now, section 2 says, subsection 2 says the commercial division to follow amended provisions in a trial of a suit in respect of commercial offer. In case of conflict with any rule of the High Court or CPC as amended by the state government, the amended provisions shall prevail. Now, this is what our High Court tells us in Bharat Bogilal Patil versus Leeds Tooling Systems. It says that the amendments introduced to the CPC by the Commercial Courts Act are only applicable to commercial disputes of specified value and not to commercial disputes, not of a specified value. So if you look at all this, in fact, the introduction of this amendment has created two categories of civil disputes. One to which the commercial, the amended provisions would apply, one to which the old CPC would apply. And again, in commercial disputes, if it is specified value, the new provisions would apply. If it is the not as of a specified value, then the old provisions would apply. Now, let us get into some of these amendments. Now, subsection 2 is added to 26 and requires the affidavit to be in the form and manner as prescribed under Order 6, Rule 15A. Now, 15A is inserted in Rule 6, requires every pleading to be verified by an affidavit in the manner and form and prescribed in the Appendix 1 to the Schedule of the Act. I've just got a slide on how this statement of truth looks like. It is just a small affidavit having 8 things that you have to say. It tells you all that is there. It is there in the appendix. It's Appendix 1. So kindly look at it. And it covers up most of the requirements, even of as far as the production of documents are concerned. So please look into that. Now, what is the consequence of non-compliance not filing the document affidavit in that manner? Party shall not be permitted to rely on such pleadings as evidence or any of the matters set out therein. Court has the discretion to strike out a pleading which is not verified by a statement of truth. Now, this is another provision that we have to look at. This basically is in money suits to make your pleadings more precise so that the courts do not face the problems that they presently face at the time of passing judgments in your matters. Probably as far as interest is concerned. Now, here you are when the suit is for recovery of money. If the plaintiff is seeking interest, it has to state whether the plaintiff is seeking interest within the meaning of Section 34 of the Code. It has to state further whether the plaintiff is doing so under the terms of the contract or under any act. If it is claimed under any act, the act is to be specified. If it is on some other basis, the plaintiff must state the basis. The plaintiff must also state the rate at which the interest is claimed, the date from which it is claimed, the date up to which it is calculated, the total amount of interest claimed to the date of calculation, and the daily rate at which the interest accrues after that date. So see, nothing is left to the imagination of the bench. You have to tell us. And that will give the defendant a chance to meet your pleadings, the plaintiff's pleadings. That is the purpose of these. Now, another important thing is the outer limit of outer for filing written statements by substitution of the provisors to Order 5, Rule 1, Order 8, Rule 1, and addition of provisors to Order 8, Rule 10, CPC. All the three provisions which are interconnected are amended to make the outer limit for filing written statement as 120 days. Now this is the Supreme Court judgment where it says that the defendant shall forfeit the right to file a written statement and the court shall not allow the written statement to be taken on record beyond 120 days. Now, here the Bombay High Court tells us, even if the plaintiff is ready and willing for a belated written statement to be taken on record, subject to payment of costs, it is important to note that the parties cannot, by consent, vest the court with discretion, jurisdiction, or powers which it otherwise is barred from exercising under the statute. This is, I mean, a common law principle. Now, this was a case of the Delhi High Court where the parties, the defendant filed applications, one for written of plaint and one for rejection of plaint. It did not seek for extension of time to file a written statement. And the Honorable High Court of Delhi said, this time for filing the written statement in a commercial suit will not get extended beyond the prescribed period till the disposal of the application under Order 7, Rule 10 and 11. Now, the judgments of the Apex Court and other high courts were placed before the court. The earlier judgment which said that these are only procedural rules and not mandatory, and then it can be granted in special circumstances. And the High Court said, no, it cannot be there in view of the specific provisions, and that the earlier judgment did not consider the new provisions of the amended act, amended CPC. So that is. Now, this is another very important, this talks about denials of pleadings. Rule 3A to Order 8, it says that denials to pleadings have to be specific and precise. Three things. The defendant is required to plead which of the allegations of the particulars in the plaint he denies, which of them he admits, and which of them he is unable to admit or deny, but which he requires the plaintiff to prove. Now, if there are denials, the law looks at denials of three things. One is denial of a fact. Second is denial of jurisdiction. Third is denial of an valuation. In all the three situations, if there is a denial, the defendant must state his reasons for doing so, for denying. In case of a denial of a fact, he must state his own version if he intends to put forward a different version of the events from that given by the plaintiff. In case of denial of jurisdiction, he must give his own statement as to which court ought to have jurisdiction, or if it is to the value of the suit, what according to him the value should be. Now, if any allegation of fact in the plaint is not denied in the manner provided under Rule 3A, it shall be taken to be admitted. The only exception is in respect of a person under disability. Now, this is another new provision which is introduced by substituting Section 35 of the CPC, which deals with costs. Under this section, the court has the discretion to determine whether costs are payable by one party to the other, the quantum of those costs, and when they are to be paid. Costs could be relating to the fees and expenses of witnesses incurred, legal fees and expenses incurred, any other expenses incurred in connection with the proceedings. How the court comes to know about this, we'll see a little later. The court can make an order deviating from the general rule by which the unsuccessful party shall be ordered to pay the costs of the successful party. Now, the general rule is that costs follow the event. Here, under the amended provision, the court has powers to deviate from this general rule. Now, what will the court consider? The conduct of the parties, whether a party has succeeded on a part of its case, even if that party has not been wholly successful, whether the party had made a frivolous counterclaim leading to a delay in the disposal of the case, whether any reasonable offer to settle is made by a party and unreasonably refused by the other party, and whether the party has made a frivolous claim and instituted a vexatious proceeding, wasting the time of the court. Now, the court is empowered to order a proportion of another party's costs. That is a part of the cost. A stated amount in respect of another party's cost. Costs from or until a certain date. Costs incurred before the proceedings have begun. Costs relating to particular steps taken in the proceedings. Costs relating to a distinct part of the proceedings. And interest on cost from or until a certain date. If you look at this, if the presiding officer has to be very active and should know and understand the conduct of the parties at various stages of the proceedings, prior to the proceedings, during the proceedings, and on the basis of this, use their powers. Now, Order 11 has been substituted, which deals with disclosure, discovery, and inspection of documents. Now, under the amended provisions, parties are required to file a list of all the documents in their power. These are very important provisions. It says that the parties to file a list of all documents in their power, possession, control, or custody, along with the plaint, including documents referred to in and relied in the pleadings, relating to any matter in question in the proceedings, irrespective of whether the same is in support or adverse to their case or defense. The party has to be fair. The list of documents should specify whether the documents in their power, possession, control, or custody are originals or photocopies, and also set out in brief details of parties to each document, mode of execution, issuance of receipt, and line of custody. The party shall not be allowed to rely, please bear this in mind, party shall not be allowed to rely on documents which were in their power, I'm sorry, there's a typographical error there, their power, possession, control, or custody, and not disclosed along with the plaint or written statement or within the extended period set out above, save as except by the leave of the court, and such leave shall be granted only upon the plaintiff establishing reasonable cause for non-disclosure along with the plaint. Now, the Delhi High Court in this judgment, Nitin Gupta versus Texmaco Infrastructure, observed that unless the commercial divisions start enforcing rules legislated for commercial suits and refuse to entertain applications for rate filing of documents and continue to show leniency in the name of interest of justice, and a litigant ought not to suffer for the default of the advocate, the commercial suits will start suffering from the same malady with which the ordinary suits have come to suffer. Commercial divisions is thus not required to entertain or allow applications for late filing of documents without any good cause being established for non-disclosure thereof along with the plain things. So the two things that we normally hear while hearing arguments on an application for late production of documents are covered up by this judgment. And it further says, late filing of documents is permitted applying the test of reasonable cause of non-disclosure of the document of at any stage provided for filing thereof. I'm sorry. I got distracted with someone changing clothes somewhere. On one of your screens, please shut your videos if you want to do or change clothes or whatever it is. I get distracted. I'm sorry. This judge, I was here. The late filing of documents is permitted applying the test of reasonable cause of non-disclosure of a document at a stage provided for filing thereof. An applicant now is required to satisfy the court as to why the document was not in his knowledge, and if in his knowledge, why the document was not disclosed at the appropriate time. So this is the sole or main consideration which the court will have to look into while deciding an application for production of a late document. Now, the pleadings, coming back to the list of documents, the pleading should contain a declaration on oath that all documents in their power, possession, control or custody have been disclosed and that they do not have any other document in their power, possession, control or custody. The pleading should set out details of documents which they believe are in the power, possession, control or custody of the other party and which they wish to rely upon. In the case of the plaintiff, the plaintiff must seek leave for production of such documents by the defendant. In the case of the defendant, the written statement or counterclaim should state that the plaintiff has not disclosed them in the plain and should call upon the plaintiff to produce the same. Now, provisions for discovery by interrogator is provided by Rule 2, which is basically or more or less the same as that existing. So I don't think we should detain ourselves on that. Now, admission and denials of documents. Now, each party is required to submit a statement of admissions of denials of all documents disclosed and of which inspection has been completed. The statement should set out explicitly whether such party was admitting or denying. There are five things of the document which are covered up. One, correctness of contents of the documents. Two, the existence of the documents. Three, the execution of the document. Four, issuance or receipt of a document. And five, the custody of a document. Now, if the existence of the document is admitted, it should include the admission or denial of the contents of that document. Now, every denial should set out reasons for denying. Bare denials and unsupported denials will not be deemed to be denials of a document. Of course, there is an exception in case of third party documents of which the party denying does not have any personal knowledge of and to which the party denying is not a party to in any manner whatsoever. Now, affidavit confirming the correctness of the contents of the statement of admission and denial is also required to be filed. And the court may impose costs, including exemplary costs, for deciding on admissibility of the document in case of unduly refusal to admit. Now, I must share with you one good practice that one of the offices of the lawyers had followed in my court before me. He prepared a chart where containing in the first column, he listed all the documents of the other party. In the second column, he divided each document into five of the requirements. Then the next column denied or admitted each of those five things of each of the documents. And in the next column, wherever he had denied, gave the reasons for denials. It's so very assisting to the court. I mean, we don't have to waste the time, judicial time to look at different parts, what he's trying to have if you write it. And that was so easy. So I would in fact recommend everyone to prepare such a table when you file your statement of admissions and denials. Prepare it in that manner so that everything becomes easy for everyone. Otherwise, the other side has to go through and all commercial suits have got so many documents. So the plaintiffs, you are preparing the list of documents, going through everything. The defendant again is going through the entire thing, wasting his time, the lawyer of the defendant. Then the court is trying to find out what you have admitted. If it is in a tabular manner, it makes job easier. Everyone's job easier. So I very strongly recommend that chart. Yes. And then moving forward, order 11, rule 6 discusses about documents which are in the form of electronic records. It says that furnishing of printouts is sufficient compliance of the disclosure and inspection of electronic documents. At the discretion of the parties or where parties wish to rely on audio or video content, copies of electronic records may be furnished in electronic form, either in addition to or in lieu of the printouts. This is where parties wish to rely on audio and video content. Now, sub-rule 3 specified what the declaration on oath by the party should contain, where electronic, please remember, this is where electronic records form part of the documents. I have just made a slide of what the sub-rule says. It says it should specify the parties to such electronic record, the manner in which such electronic record was produced, who had produced it, the dates, times of its preparation, storage or issuance of the receipt, the source of such electronic record, the date and time when it was printed, the case of email IDs, details of its own ownership, custody access, in case of documents stored on a computer or on a server, details of ownership of all that, deponent's knowledge to the contents and correctness, whether computer or computer resource was functioning properly or in malfunction, such that such malfunction did not affect the contents of the document stored, and that the printout or copy furnished was taken from the original computer or the computer resource. Now, summary judgment. This is another very interesting addition to the procedure dealing with commercial suits. It gives the commercial court powers to decide a claim without recording oral evidence, without recording oral evidence. Let us bear that in mind. Such claims may include part of a claim, any particular question on which the claim depends, or a counterclaim. Any party can apply for a summary judgment at any time after the summons have been served on the defendant, but before the court has framed the issues. Please remember, it has to be before issues have been framed by the court. Now, such application cannot be made in a suit which is originally filed as a summary suit under Order 37. Now, Order 13 Rule A, Rule 4 prescribes the procedure and what the application and replies respectively should contain. I have a slide of the rules, sub-rules. It says that the application must contain a statement that is an application for summary judgment made under this order. It has to be, must contain a statement that it is an application for summary judgment made under this order. It must precisely disclose all material facts and identify the point of law, if any. If the applicant seeks to rely upon documentary evidence, the applicant must include such documentary evidence in its application, identify the relevant content of such documentary evidence, and state the reason why there are no real prospect of succeeding or to the claim or defending the claim. It must also state what relief the applicant is seeking and briefly state the grounds for seeking such relief. Now, in the reply, the respondent shall disclose all material facts, identify the point in law, of law, if any, state the reasons why the relief sought for by the applicant should not be granted, whether it is for dismissal or grant of decree in the suit. If the respondent seeks to rely upon documentary evidence in its reply, he must include such documentary evidence in its reply, identify again, like how the applicant has to do, must also state the reason why there are real prospects of succeeding on the claim or defending the claim, as the case may be. The reply must concisely state the issues that should be framed for trial. It must identify what further evidence shall be brought on record at trial that could not be brought on record at the stage of summary judgment, and why, in the light of the evidence or material on record, if any, the court should not proceed to summary judgment. Now, if you see the nomenclatures, it says petitioner and respondent. So irrespective of whether you are the plaintiff or the defendant, either of the parties can file an application for summary judgment. Now, summary judgment can be given against the plaintiff or defendant if the court considers that the plaintiff has no real prospect of succeeding on the claim, or the defendant has no real prospect of successfully defending the claim, as the case may be, and there is no other compelling reason why the claim should not be disposed of before recording of oral evidence. Now, this is what the court may order. The court may make a judgment on the claim. The court may pass a conditional order. It may dismiss the application. It may dismiss part of the claim and pass a judgment on the part of the claim that is not dismissed. It may strike out the pleadings, whether in whole or in part, or issue further directions to proceed with case management under Order 15A. Now, when it is a conditional order, now where it appears to the court that it is possible that a claim or a defense may succeed, but it is improbable that it shall do so. Now, when a court makes a conditional order, it may make it subject to the following conditions. It may require a party to deposit a sum of money in the court. It may require a party to take a specified step in relation to the claim or defense, as the case may be. It may require a party, as the case may be, to give such security or provide such surety for restitution of costs as the court deems fit proper, impose such other condition, including providing security for restitution of losses that any party is likely to suffer during the pendency of the suit, as the court may deem fit in its discretion. And secondly, the court should specify the consequences of the failure to comply with the conditional order, including passing up judgment against the party that have not complied with the conditional order. Now, if you see the scheme of the act, of the provisions, you start with the documents, everything, all the documents, whether all the documents which are connected with the matter are to be produced, whether they support your case or whether they affect you adversely, are to be there before the court. The other side inspects it. Then they admit or deny. If it is a denial, the denial cannot be a vague denial. It has to be for specific reasons. Then if all the documents, if all the evidence is there before, documentary evidence is there before the court, then probably on the basis of those documents itself, the court could pass a summary judgment. So we don't get into the nitty-gritties of a trial. Only in a cases where it requires to go into trial, requires that it needs to get into trial, like in a conditional order, there probably it would go in for, the court would prefer to go in for trial. Now see the consequences in a conditional order. The conditional order is only to secure that the other party is not objecting to a summary judgment for the sake of objecting to it. If he is serious, then he has to fulfill these conditions. And once you fulfill these conditions, then it is fairness to all the parties involved. Now, the Delhi High Court, this was a very interesting case before the Honorable High Court of Delhi in Bright Enterprises Private Limited versus MJ Biscard. Now, this was a case that the Honorable single judge of the commercial division, before the defendant was put in appearance, found that the case is not fit for not fit to be decided, and passed a summary judgment because it was, considering that it was a plaint filed under the Commercial Courts Act. In appeal before the division bench, before the Commercial Appellate Division, a division bench of the High Court says that the provisions relating to summary judgments are exceptional in nature and out of the ordinary course, and therefore it is essential that the stipulations are followed scrupulously, otherwise it may result in gross injustice. The court looked at the situation where everything had to be disclosed, different facts have to be disclosed, different circumstances had to be disclosed in applications for summary judgment. I think even an oral application or the court sua motor cannot go in for it. That probably appears to be the scheme of the provisions, that a court sua motor cannot go in for summary judgment. Now, case management hearing. This is order 15, rule A. 15A, sorry, 15A. Now, this basically is to make orders as to framing of issues. Three things it takes care of: framing of issues, fixing the schedule, and setting time limits to address oral arguments. It fixes schedules for listing of witnesses, filing of affidavits and evidence, recording of evidence, filing written arguments, and oral arguments. Now, the court has very wide powers in a case management hearing, including the powers to strike off the name of any witness or evidence that the court deems irrelevant to the issues framed, direct a separate trial of any issues, decide the order in which the issues are to be tried, exclude an issue from consideration, reject an affidavit of evidence for containing irrelevant, inadmissible, or argumentative material, strike off any parts of the affidavit of evidence filed by the parties containing irrelevant, inadmissible or argumentative material. Order any party to file and exchange a costs budget. Now, while discussing on the costs, I told you to just remind that because there are different aspects of the costs. And this takes care of that. The parties at the during this time has to file and exchange a cost budget, which showing the probable expenses or costs that would be incurred for the purpose of the suit or conducting the matter. Now, the court can hold case management hearings anytime during the trial to issue appropriate orders so as to ensure adherence by the parties to the dates fixed and facilitate speedy disposal of the suit. When the court passes an order in exercise of such powers, it may make it subject to conditions, including a condition to pay a sum of money into the court and specify the consequence of failure to comply with the order or a condition. Now, what are the orders that the court can pass in case of non-compliance? Three things: condone such non-compliance by payment of costs to the court, foreclose the non-compliance party's right to file affidavits, its right to conduct cross-examination, its right to file written submissions, its right to address oral arguments or make further arguments in the trial as the case may be, or the third one is dismiss the plaint or allow the suit where such non-compliance is willful, repeated, and the imposition of cost is not adequate to ensure compliance. Now, sub-rules 1A, 1B, and 1C are added to Order 18, Rule 4, where it is said that the affidavits of evidence of all witnesses whose evidence is proposed to be led by a party are required to be filed simultaneously by that party at that time directed in the first case management hearing. That means if the plaintiff, if any of the party has listed N number of witnesses, the affidavits of all the N number of witnesses of the party are to be filed simultaneously. Now the question does arise whether the plaintiff as well as the defendants have to partner to file it at one time. Here also I've got some assistance from the bar. And my view after the assistance from the bar is that first it has to be the court at the time of case management hearing will have to fix a date for filing of affidavits of the witnesses of the plaintiff, then conduct dates for cross examination of those witnesses, then dates for filing the affidavits of the witnesses of the defendants, or 1, 2, 3, 5, what as the case may be. Now, a party cannot lead additional evidence by the affidavit of any witness, including a witness who has already filed an affidavit, unless sufficient cause is made out in an application for that purpose and an order giving reasons permitting such additional affidavit is passed by the court. So if you see at the time of case management hearing, you are giving a list of witnesses. Then we are scheduling the case management hearing. Then the trial moves on. And then finally, subsequently, if you want to produce additional evidence, you have to justify. And we have till now seen how the courts are called upon to interpret the provisions of the Act. Now, a party has the right to withdraw any of the affidavits filed at any time prior to the commencement of the cross-examination of the witness without any adverse inference being drawn based on such withdrawal. However, any of the other parties will be entitled to tender as evidence and rely upon any admission made in such withdrawn affidavit. Now, rules 4, 5, and 6 are added to Order 19 of the Code, giving more powers to the court to control and regulate the evidence as to issues on which it requires evidence, the manner in which such evidence may be placed before the court, and to exclude evidence that would otherwise be produced by the parties. Rule 5 gives powers to the court to redact or order the redaction of such portions of the affidavit and examination in chief as do not, in its view, constitute evidence, or return or reject an affidavit or examination in chief as not constituting admissible evidence. Now, Rule 6 gives us the format and guidelines of the affidavit of evidence. I have for our benefit got these rules here. It says that it should be confined to and should follow the chronological sequence of the dates and events that are relevant for proving any fact or any other matter dealt with. Where the court is of the view that an affidavit is a mere reproduction of the pleadings or contains the legal grounds of any of the party's case, the court may, by order, strike out the affidavit or such part of the affidavit as it deems fit and proper. Each paragraph of the affidavit should, as far as possible, be confined to a distinct portion of the subject. An affidavit should state which of the statements in it are made from the deponent's own knowledge and which are matters of information or belief. The source from which for any matters of information or belief, and an affidavit should have the pages numbered consecutively as a separate document or as one of the several documents contained in the file, be divided into numbered paragraphs, have all the numbers including dates expressed in figures, and if any of the documents referred to in the body of the affidavit are annexed to the affidavit or any other pleadings, give the annexures and page numbers of such documents that are relied upon. So it brings in a lot of discipline in the affidavit itself and makes everybody's job a lot more easier. Now, this is one of the most important part of the amendments. It gives timelines for everything at all the stages, at all that is required under the Act. Completion of pre-institution mediation within 3 months from the date of application made by the plaintiff. It can be extended for a further period of 2 months with the consent of the parties. Filing of written statement within 30 days from the date of service, not beyond 120 days. Filing of additional documents by plaintiff in urgent filing within 30 days of filing of the suit. This is because in case of urgent filing, the plaintiff can seek, because of the urgency, plaintiff can seek leave to produce his documents subsequently. But within 30 days, they have to be filed in court. Now, decision on an application seeking leave to deliver interrogatories within 7 days from the date of filing of the application. This is also there in the old code. So there's no change in this. Answering interrogatories within 10 days or within such other time as the court may allow. This is also similar to the earlier one. Completion of inspection of documents within 30 days of the date of filing of the written statement or the written statement of the counterclaim, whichever is later, can be extended by the court upon application at its discretion, but not beyond 30 days in any event. Now, disposal of an application seeking inspection of production of documents by the other party of which inspection was refused, or documents have not been produced despite issuing of a notice of produced. Now, if such application is filed, it has to be decided within 30 days of filing of such application. And if this is decided, inspection has to be furnished within 5 days of the order. Now, admissions and denials of documents within 15 days of the completion of inspection of documents or any other later date as fixed by the court. Production of documents on applications by the party not less than 7 days and not more than 15 days. First case management hearing not later than 4 weeks from the date of filing of affidavit of admission or denial of documents by all the parties to the suit. Recording of evidence as far as possible on a day-to-day basis. Filing of written arguments within 4 weeks prior to commencing the oral arguments. Here there's a provision. The provisions are that before starting off oral arguments, the parties are required to file your written arguments. Then revised written arguments, not more than 1 week after the date of conclusion of arguments. Time limit for completion of trial, not later than 6 months from the date of the first case management hearing. Pronouncement of judgment within 90 days of the conclusion of arguments. Filing of appeal within 60 days from the date of judgment. Disposal of appeal within 6 months from the date of filing. Question is whether Limitation Act applies. Yes, it can be, Section 5 can be invoked. This is what our High Court tells us in Kalpesh Jain versus Mahadev Tubes Private Limited, that it can be invoked and applied in requesting to set up Swensor to condone delay beyond a period of 60 days in presenting filing it, provided there is sufficient cause for the same. Yes, I think that is all. Thank you very much. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for the very engrossing talk.
Yeah. Excuse me for a minute.
We would like to start with the interactive session.
That's fine. Yes.
Hold on for a minute.
I think some problem with my volume. I can't hear you very clearly.
Can you hear me, sir? Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yeah, it's a little better now.
Okay. Now, the first question.
Yes.
By Advocate Tina Xavier Afonso. The question is as such: if the pecuniary jurisdiction is lex of the Commercial Code as per the new notification, then the arbitration matters and the matters wherein the state is a party having value of less than 50 lakhs. They have to be filed in the district court under the Arbitration Act and the Goa Civil Courts Act. So why this dual thing?
No, there is no dual jurisdiction. If we remember, Section 10. Only those matters. Commercial court will have jurisdiction to try only those matters which are of a specified value, either whether it may be arbitration or it may be a suit.
Correct.
So only if it is the specified value, then it will get. Otherwise, it is the normal procedure. I mean, there are no two jurisdictions.
No, but there will be one with of a commercial nature and one which is not of a commercial nature.
Exactly. That is what the Act has done. It has created two categories of civil disputes.
Yes. Especially the government, when the government is involved under Explanation 2 of the Act.
Yes, government. I mean, I know government is involved. That's fine. But we have looked at that. I think Section 26 of the Goa Civil Courts Act. Let me look at it. For that matter, I think we can look at the Commercial Courts Act itself.
Yes.
In fact, that was the situation that came to my mind at the time of transferring those cases. Whether I could, because if you look at the Civil Courts Act, the principal, the district courts would have jurisdiction. Whereas if you look at the Commercial Courts Act, it is the commercial courts would have jurisdiction. Then if you look at the explanation to the Section 2, we have seen, it would not cease to be a commercial dispute just because the government is a party. Then we also look at 21, which says save as otherwise provided, Act to have an overriding effect. The provisions of this Act shall have effect, notwithstanding anything inconsistent therein contained in any other law for the time being in force or in any other instruments having effect or by virtue of any law for the time being in force or other than this Act. Then I think our High Court in recently, of course, that matter is also under challenge before the Apex Court in Gaurang Mangesh Shumtankar has discussed this. Though the government was not a party in this, then but Justice Seshadri Naidu has very, very lucidly explained how the jurisdiction would lie. So I think there should be no issues there. And even if you look at the Goa Civil Courts Act, if we look at 26, the proviso to section 26, it says that there's a proviso there which says that the government may, by general or special order, notified in the official gazette, direct that the provisions of this section shall not apply to any suit or class of categories or category of suit of the nature referred to therein. So instead of keeping a void, we cannot keep a void in the law. So we will have to, till if at all the government thinks of, if at all there is some inconsistency, they can in fact go under that proviso. And till that void is filled, I think we will have to harmoniously look into the provision so that we don't create a void and say, no, we cannot, the parties cannot be left without a remedy.
Okay. Question number two is whether a bank recovery matter of a specified value be treated as a commercial suit.
Yeah, I think this is the first definition. I think we have looked at it a little deeply also. Unless it is connected with the second part of it, a solicitor suit for recovery, I think, is not maintainable under the, would not be a commercial dispute.
The next,
and I think just moving forward there, I think, and why would, I mean, I think there are better remedies in debt tribunals and SARFAESI. I think there are more quicker.
Now, the next question is, what would happen to those matters which were earlier treated as commercial suit and after the notification, they have been transferred to the trial court below the specified value? Will they be transferred as normal civil suits or will they be?
Definitely, there will be normal special civil suits. There will be normal special civil suits.
Next is, what procedure would be followed if already half of the suit has been dealt with under the Commercial Courts Act?
Here we have to understand one thing, that the commercial court has not created any rights. I mean, it has only changed procedure. That also not very this thing. It has only post timelines. It has made parties more responsible. I mean, there is nothing to lose either way. I mean, in fact, it was better that, I mean, even otherwise, this is a better procedure.
Yes.
So, I mean, the choice is yours.
Okay, the next question is whether non-production of statement of truth, is it a curable defect?
Now, here again, we have to look at one thing. What is the law on the subject as far as verification of the pleadings? Nothing of that sort is changed. Only the manner in which the verification is to be done is changed. So it's still a curable defect in my view, of course, subject to correction.
The next question is, Order 11, Rule 6.3 is more or less the same as Section 65B, that is electronic evidence.
Yes.
Can that be considered as sufficient compliance?
I don't think so. Here the Act requires you to do something very specific, so do it in that manner. And that might help you at a subsequent stage at the time of leading evidence. So it cannot be the other way around. This might help you there. That might not help you here.
The next question is from Advocate Jatin Ramaiah. He says, whether the designation civil judge would be said to be met the objective of fact, particularly where a lower court value commercial arbitration goes to the principal district judge and a higher value goes to civil judge. So basically he's asking the same thing. When a higher level commercial arbitration will go to a civil judge senior division, and a lower value commercial transaction would go to the principal district judge.
Well, that definitely, I mean, that finally we have to leave it to the wisdom of the legislature.
The next question is, if there is an order to proceed without a defendant's written statement, can then the plaintiff move an application for summary judgment, and can the court decide it without leading evidence?
Now here is a situation you will have to look at the provisions of the CPC. The provision of the CPC as it stands, except for those provisions which are amended, the rest of are all applicable. We'll have to see what are the remedies available to the plaintiff if the defendant in the normal suit does not come. What are the provisions if the defendant comes and admits? all those provisions have to be read along with this. I mean, you are not separating the CPC here. Yes. We are reading the old CPC with the amended provisions. Only in the situations where the provisions are amended, we have to read in the amended provisions. Otherwise, all the provisions in CPC would apply.
The next question is, a party cannot lead additional evidence. That's what Your Honor had said. Would that include rebuttal evidence?
No, it's not that. Please don't this thing. I think I'll see if I can get that slide again. Just a minute. I'll see if I can get that slide again. Anyway, I think it is taking time, so I will let us not. I'll read that provision. I'll read that provision.
Yes.
Additional evidence. It says it's not a blanket thing. It says that. Such ideas, unless sufficient cause is made out in the application for an order giving reasons permitting such additional evidence is passed by the court. And finally, once again, if the CPC gives the party a right to lead evidence in rebuttal, definitely you would be. So in that case, looking at all the provisions at the time of the case management hearing, a date could be fixed so that would take care of that. If the party does not wish to file any affidavit in rebuttal, I mean, so be it. So that could take care of it. So at the first case hearing, for case management hearing, we have everything before us and we have the entire probable schedule there.
The next question is, after the amendment incorporating the new mediation rules, would the impact of Section 89 CPC be somewhat affected?
Not at all. Absolutely no chance there, because here you are coming before. See, it's not the other way around. Before, you were coming before the court and the court was directing you, I mean, sending you there. Here you are going there and coming before the court. So probably even after that, you still have a chance. In fact, the case management, if you read the provisions, there is a provision that the court can refer you to mediation once again.
Now, there is a question in the chat box. It says that would an application for execution of a foreign award in an international commercial arbitration required to be filed in a commercial court?
Section 10.
Yes.
This makes three, it distinguishes between the two awards, international commercial award and which is not a commercial award, international commercial award. International commercial award, it will come before the court.
Okay. The next question is, during the pendency of a commercial dispute, if the company becomes insolvent and it is declared so by the company tribunal, then what would be the result of the pending proceedings?
The same result as will be the other suits. I mean, nothing changes. Only the procedure changes. That's it. We are only changing. I mean, amendment is only as far as to the procedure. Nothing. I mean, no substantial rights are touched, except those that might be caused by procedure. A non-filing of written statement, except for those rights, but nothing else is created.
The next is, a written statement in a summary suit can be filed only after leave is allowed. Is this the same thing here after 120 days?
Here what will happen is what has happened. In fact, there is a judgment of our High Court which says that if it is a summary suit, I'll just see if I have it here. Summary suit. I'm sorry, I don't think I can know. Just a minute, I still see if it is here. In fact, I don't know if it is. It's our High Court. It says that the procedure to be followed there. Procedure to be followed there would be the summary. What is applicable to the summary suits and not this. Oh yeah, it's. I think it is. Yeah, I think I have it. I'll just share this with you. Just a minute. Eh? Down summary judgment. Yes. I'll just share the screen and I'll give you the document. Where is that? This one? Oh yes. No. Yes. This is the judgment. Hubtown Limited versus IDBI. This is the division bench judgment, and let us straight away go to those observations. Para 24, I think, is the one. There's some problem with my laptop. The mouse is not working. So I'm trying to. Error 24, sorry. Yes. This very, very beautifully separates the two. And this is, I mean, please go through it. And finally, what it says is that order 13A rule 1-3 of CPC, whereby it is specifically provided not with so and so. Therefore, once the summary suit as originally filed prior to the commencement of the and as of now transferred being commercial dispute matter, the original procedure as provided under Order 37 rule shall be applicable to such summary suits. The parties are not entitled to a prayer for summary judgment under 13A in view of the specific provisions so referred above. This means that the judgments and the issues so decided in a summary suit shall for all purpose be governed by the CPC even after such suits are transferred as commercial suits. And the commercial division is required to follow the original CPC and is required to keep in mind the position of law revolving around all the facets of summary suits. So this is what the court has said.
Another question is whether Order 7, Rule 11, rejection of plaint is applicable.
It should yes, be. I mean all procedure is.
The next question is: does an execution proceedings of a commercial nature come into this ambit?
Yes, it will be an application, right? It will be an application.
I guess there are no other questions, sir. I think we should end the question answer session here. I would like to call upon Mr. Pritam Morais to deliver the vote of thanks.
Yes, Prasad, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Thank you. On behalf of G.R. Kare College of Law Alumni Association, I express my gratitude to Honorable District Judge 1 and Additional Session Judge, Mr. Edgar Fernandez. Thank you, sir, for sharing with us your valuable time and knowledge. The presentation, as we all saw, was well researched. It reflected your expertise on the topic. Occasions are rare where advocates get to cross-examine a member of the judiciary. Today, on behalf of us all, Advocate Adish took this opportunity. I would also say that G.R. Kare College of Law is proud of gifting the judiciary with a judge of your caliber. At the same time, we are sad that we lost a very good teacher. We look for the reverse action where someday after you retire, we could also see the prospect of coming back to teaching. I thank the President, Advocate Prasad Naik, for taking this initiative. I thank Advocate Adish and Advocate Riha for bringing color to this event by hosting this function so very gracefully. I thank you all for joining us in this webinar. Once again, a very big thank you. God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you. You may now all leave the meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. And I would prefer more cross-examination rather.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Takes us deeper into the subject.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you.